So there we go. So you all know about computer tomography. It's been around forever, hasn't it? But actually it was invented, and it was invented somewhere in the 60s of the previous century by Hansfield and Cormack. And basically you see here on the picture, you see what the prototype looked like. You have a scanning x-ray source and a detector, and then the object would rotate, and in that way a CT scan would be made. Now, the CT scanner, the idea is beautiful, but you have to make it actually a working device. And there was this record company called EMI, for instance, Pink Floyd, but also they made a shitload of money with Pink Floyd and the Beatles, and they invested it into creating the first CT scanner, the EMI CT scanner. And if you go to the Science Museum in London, you see the CT scanner there. It's a brain scanner, so it's quite small. And there is a big rack with computing stuff. And if you zoom in a little bit, you see a computer. And that computer is a Data General Nova 800. And if you're interested in computer history, there's actually a book about the development of in that company called The Soul of a New Machine. So I've sold one of those computers on eBay. So I bid and I won, and for £250, I got a crate at home. And it's a Nova 1210, which is a slower version of the same computer. So I took it apart, and you see there's lots of boards and stuff, and actually the boards are big. I got this from a guy in America, and I was telling him about this project, and I said, I'm missing this board, so he gave it to me, and it was brought over by my friend just now, so I just got it yesterday. So the CPU in the Nova is made with TTL ICs. I don't know if that says anything, but basically there are small scale integration. So the biggest one has maybe 30 gates, the smallest one has 4 gates, and that makes the whole CPU. It's about 100 chips, so it's all very discrete. You know, there's no microprocessor on it. This is the microprocessor. What is brilliant about this computer is that it's on one board. And before that, it wasn't the case. Computers were made of multiple boards, and the guys who designed this, they worked for digital equipment, and digital equipment weren't interested in their idea, so they ran away and started their own company, which is Data General. Now, the memory is also very, very interesting, because if you program, you might have heard of a core dump. You think, oh, that's the core, you know, that's the center of the program. Well, that's not what it means. It means a dump of the memory, which is a core memory. And why is it called a core memory? Because under this black plate, there is a very intricate woven mass of magnetic cores. And that is the core memory. So the core memory records the data by being magnetized. So the cores can be magnetized in one direction or the other direction. And if you put a high current through the wires, which are really thin, they're as thinner as a hair, you can change the magnetization and you can store information. So I got the computer and it's all beautiful, but there was a bit missing, because it came from a photo typesetter. It came from like a printer. So it was an embedded computer, and it didn't have any I/O, it didn't have the front panel. The front panel is where you program a computer in the old days. You can toggle the switches and load information into the computer. So I started building a front panel, and with lots of wires and lights, and spent quite a bit of time on that. And then a couple of months later, actually, it was the first time I turned it on. And you know, what is amazing is you turn this computer on and it shows the information that was in there. You know, the program, all the software, all the data is still in there 40 years later. It doesn't go away. So somebody told me actually that the governments are afraid of electromagnetic pulse. You've heard of that, in a nuclear bomb. And apparently the magnetic core memories are not suspected. They are not affected by that. So actually, this kind of computers seem to be in all sorts of stuff. And this guy, he makes a living by maintaining and rebuilding this kind of computers, and they're still running. So 50 years after these computers were designed. I had a little bit of an issue, a health issue in December. So I had some time at home and I didn't want to work. So instead I thought, well, my front panel with all the wires is really not working very well. So I'm going to make a nice one, because I forced time at home, not allowed to work. So I made a front panel and I used a keycard, a pre-router, and a Tensor CPU, and basically create things like this. So this is a front panel. So this is this sits in front of the computer, and you've got all the switches there, and basically you could use that to load data into the computer. But obviously, I wanted to make it a little bit smarter, so there's actually a microcontroller there, which is maybe 1,000 times more powerful than the computer it's controlling. but okay. And it basically means that through the wire, this computer is wired up to a PC. Yeah, so I can remote control the computer from at home, from here. So that's the front panel, and you might ask why this is the front panel here, that the computer is at home. But this is version 3 of the front panel, and version 2 is actually running it right now. So, but version 2 is a little bit too modern. So now, obviously, we want to do CT reconstruction. And I've written quite a bit of reconstruction code in my days, and to do that fast, you have to be smart. So you think you need sines and cosines for every pixel and all that stuff, and because it rotates around, but that's not true. You know, if you see the picture, actually, it's a linear transformation, because for every projection angle, and this is a parallel projection, you have a linear transformation between the voxels in your CT slice and your input data. So actually, what the software would look like is you just loop over the voxels in your slice, or pixels in your slice, and at every step you make a little step on your input data, which is the projection of the step size onto the direction of the input data, and that projection is constant for every slice. So so you only need a sine and cosine to be calculated once for every slice. And now I was lazy, so I actually calculated it somewhere else, and I downloaded it into the computer. So it's pre-computed, which would be how it would work anyway. You know, that's why do things over and over again if you already know what the answer is. So, and it also needs to fit. So my computer has two memory boards. I found another one and I fixed it. And actually, the total memory usage of the algorithm when it's totally completed will be in the order of 10,000 16 bits words. And I've got 16,000 bits words, so it fits easily. So, but then I need to write some software. And the TNC on the front panel, you write that in C, and I put lots of stuff in it. It's really nice. But yeah, that was not really the right development environment. So last Sunday, I wrote a little assembler in Lua, which is a week ago. And before that, I coded something on my Raspberry Pi in Python. Switch it on and off, coded an FFT table generator, and the whole code is in assembly language and it's about 100 instructions. So the thing is sitting in my garage room, and basically I've hooked it up, and so what you have is a Raspberry Pi, which is sitting over here, connecting to the internet, which connects to the computer, which connects to the Nova, and there's a power switch. So, which basically means that I can do a demo. So this is a computer sitting at home. This is a webcam, and it's off. There's no lights. So hopefully I'll be able to turn it on. So this is my Raspberry Pi that's sitting there on top. You see the little light, and turn it on, and I hope and pray. Yeah. So now we need to do a little bit of software stuff. So let's see if I can get. So this is a serial monitor, and it's connected to the microcontroller on the front panel. And I wrote a little bit of language or interpretation to be able to do things. And so on that window you see the assembly language, and. Doesn't look very pretty, but it's functional, and basically I can run the Lua program, and then it would assemble the code, and it would spit out a bunch of hex data, which I can then copy. I don't need to do this. I don't need to copy and paste it because it's still in memory. You know, if I turn it off, it doesn't go away. But yeah, it's just to demonstrate the whole process. I paste it into the terminal, and there we go. So now we have a bit of the CT reconstruction sitting ready to go. The input data is constant, so it's a bit limited. And I can show you the input data, by the way. If I know, oh, no, 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 no. Come on. can't remember what the address is where it is. So I'll show you the data later. So I can let it start it, and there we go. Running. So it's counting down, and every image is basically a back projection of one input data array. Input data arrays are constant, so it's not actually reading any data, but I've got some storage on the front panel where I can read it from, so it's not totally finished, but it's working. And actually, it's bloody fast. It's almost done. It's done. And now, and I can't display it because I don't have a medical display, so I wrote something called this, and I know it's an address 20,000, and this basically shows as ASCII characters what is in the memory, and this should be a reconstruction of a circle, and it actually didn't really work. So the code works. I know that all the words are right, but the table is there's a bug in the table that drives it. So I need to spend a little bit more time, but I ran out of time yesterday. So,
but Marcel, I see the bug. It's those cylinders at the bottom right of the picture.
Okay, so come back to the PowerPoint. Okay, so this is what the machine code looks like. So you have instructions, you have four registers, and you can move things with registers, swaps, shifts, load from memory, write to memory. So the inner loop is about 10 instructions, and that runs 6400 times for one 80x80 CT slicer. And this looks remarkably similar to the XVI reconstruction code. That the inner loop is actually a tiny bit shorter than this one, because you have more registers on a modern CPU. But yeah. Oh, and the tables are generated like this. So I made a statement that says repeat generate a word which contains a sign, cosine stuff, and then stored in memory. So that brings me to my conclusion. So I successfully restored an over 12 10 computer from 1972. So it's almost 50 years old. I think restoring old stuff is important for teaching people about computers, because I think people are all flabbergasted, oh, it's so much high tech, but it isn't. It's all just bloody the same, yeah? It doesn't make any difference. Whether you have a modern computer or old computer, it's all the same. It's just simple instructions moving bits around, and all the rest is bullshit. Yeah, sales pitch. And I used an algorithm that is very similar to the XVI reconstruction code, and I was able to reconstruct the code, an 80x80 slice in 20 seconds, which is actually 30 times faster than the original code. So either I'm smarter than them, or maybe they did it a little bit more precise than I did, but because this was very simplified. And actually, it's not totally complete, because I don't have the FFT code implemented. I have the tables and everything, but yeah, I ran out of time to code that, so I'll do that another time. Thank you for attention. It's complimentary to beer, because you know, I either go out and drink beers, or I stay at home and I'm working this thing. So actually, it's negative beers. So it took a long time. So the modern front panel that you see over there, that was like a month of evenings to design and then to code stuff. So there is loads of time in this.
Do you know if Cormac used a different approach? Because Cormac had done it with his HO train and very basic stuff. I don't think it was at this level of sophistication.
Could be, yeah. I actually don't know, so I would have to find that out. You probably know more about it than I do, because you're slightly older than me. But I love to compare, and so I think the next step is to go to the Science Museum and talk to them and see what we can do. Software would still be in there, I think.
When you're done, will you host it on a public address?
I could, yeah.
It would be fun.
It would be fun, but definitely I've asked Alan to record this, and so we'll put the movie in YouTube, and I think that would be a first step. The scary bit, of course, is if the computer starts to blow up or overheat. You know, it's a bit scary. So I asked my wife to turn on the light just now. But I can actually turn the computer off, but not the lights. Right. Okay. Well, thanks for attention.
Thank you.